everyone. My name is Karen Sori, I'm from Ukraine. I represent Ukrainian British company that's called Kozak Labs. And well, as you can see, my talk is called that not all rocket scientists want to be brain surgeons. Actually, big thanks to Chris Ward for helping to come up with this perfect title. In Kozak Labs, we develop convenient crypto tools for busy humans, which means that we make crypto stuff for developers who just want their crypto to work, because everyone knows that crypto is hard, crypto is dangerous. And well, crypto is actually really hard. There is this catchphrase in saying that, well, documenting is hard. Yeah, it's hard, but doing crypto is harder. And documenting crypto is even still more harder, because you need to like document weird stuff in weird terms for weird people who really weirdly want to use crypto that works. And that just does not come always as the case that it all works together. Well, I wanted to say what actually cryptography is and what it isn't. At first, cryptography is extremely scientific. Yeah, I know why you're laughing, I'll come to that. Cryptography is scientific, it's science about encryption, about the way you deal with information you don't want to share, about the way you want to scramble it and not unscramble it unless someone has a key. It's extremely community powered. Well, when I first came into this domain of cryptography, I said, oh my gosh, everything is going to be so secret and encrypted. Oh my gosh, probably tens of thousands of keys for everything. No! Cryptography is totally open, you know? Because unless there was a peer review of a peer review of a peer review of the underlying mathematics behind your crypto you're using, you won't be allowed to use it. They say don't roll your own crypto, because unless like 20 other mathematicians verify that it's unbreakable, you can't use it. And by the way, this Wi-Fi protocol, you remember like a month ago, it was broken down. There is a mass, a scientific actual description how it cannot be broken at all. So it's still not a guarantee, even in the community-powered community behind cryptography. And it's very fast-forward thinking. Well, some people who heard my Lightning talk in Prague know that while the whole world is trying to actually develop quantum computers, cryptographers think that quantum cryptography is yesterday, because, you know, they already in theory know how to break it. So, well, and yes, cryptography has nothing to do with Bitcoin, please. This is a typical cryptographic document that I have to deal with on a regular basis, like every day. You know, like you get a key, you get a Z, then you encrypt it by E and P, and well, yeah. That's pretty much the state of my brain every evening, but I'm getting better at it. You just have to kind of stop yourself and think that, now, if I'm a developer who's not a cryptographer, I probably don't want to know the details, I just want stuff to work. And as a person who has to give people stuff that works, I need to give them stuff that's well documented. And the thing is that when you see this P by E by K by Alice by Bob by everyone, first you're outraged and desperate. And then you realize that, you know, everything can be explained easily. Easily. Maybe you're staring into the abyss of not understanding something. But there are ways to break down really complex notions into really, really simple things. Like taking a yellow cryptographic chameleon, Felix, our mascot, actually at Kozak Labs. This is a yellow guy who can theoretically explain any crypto to anyone, and I have to do the work for him, actually. But, you know, when you leave the math and science behind, you are left with very simple words, and it's your job to put down those words and to make them work for you. Crypto is not only complicated, it's also fragile, because, you know, it has lots of dependencies on everything, so what's the use of making huge scientific breakthroughs if you know someone misplaced or misnamed a function and nothing works, and then you just lose the trust of your audience, you lose the trust of everyone. So what the hell do? You do not just keep the APIs consistent, you also keep documentation consistent, and it's an eternal back and forth. So, and in back and forth this, you need to keep the balance between being strictly scientific and being a person and a company who provides things that people can use, because they don't want your math, they don't want your silence. sense. They want something, they just put into their program and it works and it encrypts and it's perfect, right? There is a problem, you know, people I have to deal with, I love them, I really love my colleagues, but they, you cannot see it unfortunately, they're cryptographers. And cryptographers are scientists, and scientists do not like talking, you know, a lot. So, a major part of my working process as a crypto technical writer is actually coming up to people and bugging them, like, you know, what do you explain, and maybe explain again, and maybe people who are not cryptographers, they won't understand what you just explained to me, because yes, I understand that, but people, and then with the documents, they just come through 20 or 30 iterations until it's really human language. And when it's human language, at least we have lived with the document for 50 times, for 50 reviews, we think that, yeah, now it's perfectly clear for everyone, yay! And then I turn into this cat, who puts the documentation out there for people because we make open source products. And then we get the hey feedback when nothing works and no one understands just anything. So what do you do then? The thing is that you plan beforehand, because you have to think about leading people who are going to use your stuff. And unless you plan it really well, nothing's going to work, and like all your, well, the time of your days that you're spending every day is going to be just put in vain. Why? But our task as technical writers is actually to turn that chaos into something that is actually usable and making this bridge between really, really far out scientists to people who maybe don't know a lot about coding, maybe even don't know a lot about English, but want their stuff to work. So, welcome to the real world and from the theory to what I actually do. The products we create, the APIs of the products we create, they provide encryption and encryption libraries to people who want to use them. And other products we build on those libraries, they also use the underlying crypto and provide developers tools they need for the security. We use, as an open source company, we use GitHub as our developer portals for the time being, but we're going to transition from that because maybe that's not an opening, eye-opening thing for most of people here, but for us, like, it's really handy when you can click through different code parts in different languages in one place. So GitHub doesn't provide me that, so we're going to be transitioning. But currently, for example, Tignis is our main crypto library, so we just use GitHub Wiki, and it provides a very handy place to store everything from documentation and to actual tutorials. We also have simulators, which why do we need simulators? When people want to use our products, they have no idea what comes out in them because, you know, when you encrypt something successfully, you get a random string of numbers or bytes. And when you can encrypt something not successfully, you also get a random string of bytes. So you don't know if it's successful. And in electronic simulators, we provide examples where people can input preset stuff and output the stuff it's supposed to output, you know? And to see that it works indeed. So here another simulator. Tutorials are also on GitHub. And I think that for the time being, until we've transitioned, it were also quite handy to have that, because in crypto you only get the text and the code, the text and the code. As for the feedback and community, we currently use GitHub issues, but that's just the very beginning and the top of the iceberg of the way we communicate with our audience who knows nothing about crypto and wants to use it. Because, you know, sometimes we post something on Twitter, like it was this case with we displayed the underlying crypto primitive in our crypto library from OpenSSL to Libsodium, and we tagged the author of Libsodium, and we posted a huge article, and the very next day we got like 5 questions from the author, like, why the hell did you do that? Why so complicated? So sometimes the feedback can be painful, you know? But we get to be everywhere, and we get to segment, because our target audiences, they are actually 2 target audiences. They are people who don't know much about crypto, don't know much about maybe English, and just want stuff to work. And there are other people who know a lot about crypto, who are actually scientists, and who want our stuff to work in a very exotic way. In some way, sometimes we just even didn't know that it could work like that, but it does. Which is why we boldly segment. It means that, for example, we get tutorials in pairs of two. For example, it's a tutorial for an experience that, like, pip install, go, and everything works. And here is the same piece, actually not even the same, but like a part of step one and part of step two in a tutorial for a less experienced developer. Because sometimes you need to choose from things to make things work for people who are not as knowledgeable. Actually, we have this like image, we say like, there could be a 20-year-old person with a MacBook who still needs to get it right. And while we explain a lot of stuff in a lot of words to newbies on our wiki, we actually explain a lot of stuff in words on our blog. We have a scientific blog on our website, which is really scientific. It's benchmarks, it's terminology, it's some scientific discoveries. And at the same time, we have Twitter, because you know we still have to interact with people. No one will only read old grand logs, you know. People want info that they can relate to and they want to understand, something fun. So that's what a Twitter looks like. And that's what pops up in there. Also, we are scientists, and we're mathematicians, and we're cryptographers. And for people who are newbies, we also have really small, short articles with fun pictures like this. Again, Felix is a cryptographer coming on, who explains stuff. We have a series of articles that said, explain like I'm five. Because some stuff like zero-knowledge protocols, end-to-end encryption, yeah, and stuff like that, it comes through better, comes across better when you put it in such a funny way. People just relate to it. And not everyone wants to be smart all the time. Sometimes people just want it to be cool for once. And, you know, with so many things going on, first of all, we have science and we have really experienced developers who give us hell. And we have these newbie developers which we need to handle with care and sometimes hold their hands on GitHub. There are challenges we are facing. Like, we want to get lots of stuff done, but not everything gets done. Because sometimes we are torn between providing proper science and proper formulas and proper explanations for the scientific community. But then we realize that we end up putting like performance benchmark into those scientific papers, and it's wrong. Well, when we have time, we then get down in dirt and we make two versions. We make a scientific paper, we post it to IACR, and then we make an article on Medium with ducks and whatever. And then people understand it. And of course, another problem is perfectionism, because when you balance it in such a crazy schizophrenic way, then you just don't know where to stop. You don't know if it's good enough, you don't know if it's scientific enough, or if it's human enough. So that's probably the thing that we face every day, like, is it good enough? Should we stop? Should we finally freaking post it somewhere? Oh, for God's sake. Yes, we should. Well, and personally, me, I also face challenges as a technical writer in crypto. As I said, well, cryptographers don't talk much, but I'm getting better at talking to them, you know, like, cryptographers have this way of finding out stuff from people. And there is this creature which I love. Actually, I invented it, but not before I was defeated by it, like, two or three times already. It's a cryptokraken. You know what's a cryptokraken? It's, you see murky water or some information you kind of would love to write an article tutorial on. It kind of pulls this enough freaky thing like this, and it pulls, and then you end up pulling up this freaking kraken, because you find some notions that even your fellow colleagues do not know anything about. So, for example, there is an article I wrote on Kozak Labs Medium blog about the way Apple deals with registering encryption. I spent, I think, about a month reading Apple's legal documentation. I indicated every way a person who uses any kind of encryption can register and what can come with it, what can be the consequences, drawbacks, setbacks, whatever. And you know what is the proper way to register Apple? Well, no, I'll rephrase. Do you think I found out the proper way to register crypto with Apple? No. But it's still like 15-page post on Medium, which is hugely popular, and everyone somehow comes and says, "Oh, it was so useful." So everyone found out something for them from that article. But I ended up succumbing to this Kraken, who is this cryptographic Apple documentation. Well, I'm trying to fight it sometimes. Sometimes it's nice because it yields me articles and article topics, but sometimes I end up struggling for months with some really, like, in Ukrainian language we have this word which indicates construction underway, which is really, really, really long. So it turns into this really long and abandoned construction, which I am ultimately come back to, and well, it turns into a really nice octopus with lots of views on the blog. Here's a quote from a book which I really love. It's Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. For those of you who didn't read it, it's about a technical writer, I think in 1970s, who just rides across America and kind of goes crazy before and after, like, oh well, tech writers wrote life as it is. So, and it was really comforting to see that even in 1970s there was this problem that sometimes developers pretend they are busy, and sometimes you think that developers are busy and you're just too afraid to approach them, and it's very counterproductive. So, you know, the thing is what I figured out for myself, like, sorry, I'm not sorry. I'm still sorry for saying sorry every day, like, I'm sorry, please, can you send me this thing? Can I please ask you to review this? Oh, sorry, oh, please, yes, of course, oh, thank you. Please don't call the diversity officer just yet. I know it's kind of also interrelated with the imposter syndrome, but still, that's a problem I face, and I'm trying to say sorry less. But I still didn't find a way to ask politely for the info when you needed it like 3 weeks ago and you didn't have it yet. So maybe, you know, some answers you can share afterwards with me. And also language issues. The English language is not my first language. And also I have a specific education in English language. It's not the first language for most of our developers. So sometimes we get this petty fights on, like, when I'm saying that the word they use is kind of wrong from the point of view of the English language, and they think that the words, all the words I'm using are kind of wrong related to the notions they're trying to explain. And well, what I found out to be the solution is just coming up with style guides. You just have the style guides and everyone sticks to it. Maybe sometimes it brushes me against the fur, sometimes it brushes them against the fur, but being both, well, me and developers rubbed the wrong way, we kind of come up with a glossary that we can live with and we can actually share it with the world. Tools that I use, well, they may seem naive for many of you, but that's what I use and that's what I wanted to share. I write documentation in Markdown, I got it already memorized, so I use it in Notepad++. Sometimes when I need a quick review, I use Dillinger a lot. For the schemes and graphics, actually even those schemes with Doc and the infrastructure was also done in Drove.io, so it's not only for some complicated scientific stuff. And I use Grammarly as a Ukrainian also made plugin. It's a very cool spell check, which also lets you choose between the British version and the American version of English, which is very important for me because we're a British Ukrainian company, so I need to stick to British spelling. And what I wanted you to maybe take from my speech, probably the trembling speech, but as this thing that, now, even such a weird thing as cryptography can be explained, and it can be explained in a fun way. So probably, most probably, you're dealing with something which is less complicated, or maybe even more complicated than cryptography, but there are ways to find really simple words to explain it to your audience and your users. And please choose simple words, because sometimes, yeah, sure, I'm tempted to choose, like, Queen's English, and to put the notion about the implementation on this exquisite paragraph in the chapter 3 in the text, but you know, then this hacker, 18-year-old hacker from China won't understand me. So it doesn't pay to use complicated language. Just use the most simple word you can think about. That's your friend. Simple word, your friend. Think about people that are going to use your documentation. Don't put excess stuff, better put some stuff that really is necessary there. And you know, my rule of thumb is treating people who are going to read my documentation as people who are, yes, very smart, but very tired and under emergency. So that's how you come with the best way to approach a person who will read your documentation and will actually make use of it. Boldly increase number of channels you communicate through. As I said, we have Twitter, Issues, GitHub, Medium, and blog, and everything. And all of us will also have very active Twitter accounts because we want to know our audience. It's really fun to see people who are using the stuff we made. So be open, be approachable, and talk to your audience. And don't be afraid to talk to different parts of your audience in different ways and don't mix. It's all right. They are all your audience and your users. And don't be afraid to ask questions to your colleagues and to your audience and sometimes to yourself. Are you good enough? Is a bad question. Is a good question is, are you pleased with what it will bring to people? Did you do a good job? So, well, huge thank you for listening to this. And again, a special thank you to Chris Ward for helping come up with the topic. And you cannot see it because it's kind of scary though. A huge thank you to Eugene Bilankevich, my boss, who helped me shape this talk. I'm really grateful to him. Well, here are the contacts. And you see this Felix, who is staring into the cryptographic abyss, actually. Yes, after the talk, come by, say hi, I have stickers with Felix staring into cryptographic abyss, so if you want it, I get it. And please, of course, subscribe, please write me, please subscribe to us, please read our Twitter, it's really complicated but fun. So, questions?